You know, speaking of football,
back is the ability to remember what God had done in the past.
And so that's why we read the scriptures, is because we serve an almighty and powerful God. And we not only just want to stay faithful, but we want to be inspired to be used by God in incredible ways. You know, I love verse 13. As he says, your ways, God, are holy. What God is as great as our God? You know, you notice the confidence and his faith that was expressed by what came out of his mouth. You know, in verse 14, as he says, you are the God who performs miracles. You know, he goes on to describe what God does. And I find this interesting because God knows that he's incredible. And so he didn't need Asaph to tell him that he was incredible. But I believe that Asaph was just so fired up that in his prayer, in the song, he's telling God, God, you're awesome, your deeds are powerful. You know, moving on, verse 15, he says, with your mighty arm, you redeemed your people, the descendants of Jacob and Joseph. You know, perhaps the greatest work that God has ever performed is the ability to redeem his people. You know, we see some incredible miracles in the Bible. God changing the way the wind blows, or changing the stars, just doing what he wants to do. But let me encourage you guys, the greatest miracle God has ever performed has given us the ability to be redeemed by his saving grace. You know, to save a nation unto him, guys, there is no greater miracle. You know, moving on to verse 16, as he says, the waters saw you. God, the waters saw you and writhed. And I find it interesting here that Asaph chooses to personify water. He gave the water eyes, because when the water saw God, what did they do? They writhed, they squirmed. That just really inspires me of how powerful God is. You know, verse 17 and 18. You know, again, why is God showing us this? Why does he want to remind us? Because he wants to eliminate doubt from our lives. You know, verse 17 says, the clouds poured down water, the heavens resounded with thunder, your arrows flashed back and forth, your thunder was heard in the whirlwind, your lightning lit up the world, the earth trembled and quaked. You know, as I see this passage, you know, I think about, man, you know, I love to own things. I love to say, you know, my television. I love to say my Kobe Bryant basketball shoes. I love to take ownership of the things that I possess. You know what God owns? He owns thunder. He owns lightning. I mean, shoes, possession, cars, homes. We take pride in those things. God owns the thunder. Isn't that amazing? You know, verse 19 through 20, lastly, as he says, your path led through the sea, your way through the mighty waters, though your footprints were not seen. You led your people like a flock by the hand of Moses and Aaron. You know, lastly, here, one of the most famous miracles of all time that God ever performed was when he parted the Red Sea. And as Israel was being crossed over there in trouble, being on the run from the Egyptians, you just picture in your mind, whether you've read the Bible and you put pictures in your head, or you've seen some movies that attempt to describe what God had done on that day. And then as the Israelites passed through, you know, and then the Egyptians came across, God closed up the water. You know, why are these stories so important to us churches? Because we can eliminate doubt from our lives by believing in God's great works. You know, as we read these and we're inspired by these, we are facing our reality though. And that reality is, it's so easy to forget hurt you. Or all of a sudden, you just got into a conflict with your spouse. That happened for me last weekend. At church. And I was looking forward to the fellowship because God moved in a powerful way. We heard Walter preach the word. Over the course of the weekend, we saw several baptized into Christ. And I had the privilege, along with several other brothers and sisters, to be a part of those in the study series, Counting the Cost, helping our brothers and sisters to get baptized. So there was a great work going on that morning that God was doing. And then before the first song, in the front of the stage, there was an intense look of a woman looking in into my eyes as we were having a disagreement about the order of service. And to top it all off, as there was intensity and there was uncomfortability, Walter comes over. How you guys doing? Don't let it interrupt your worship. I can share that story because we did work it out. Okay? Talking out, I apologize, I was humble. And God still did a great work in that day. Perhaps the greatest work was me being humble. Have you forgotten? Have you forgotten about the great works that God has done in your life? You know, can you sit there and go, man, I remember when I was in the campus ministry. But yet your life right now isn't quite up to that zeal and that fervor that you once served the Lord. Have you forgotten about the great works of God? And I remember it was about 12 years ago. We had come out of the ministry for a period of time just to figure out life. And we traveled over to the West Coast and connected with the church in San Francisco. And we got tied in. We were faithful. But there was just something missing. And I remember the minister sitting us down and looking in my eyes and going, you know, Felipe, you can't sit on the sideline forever. And I remember it was in that moment that I realized that, you know, I have forgotten. You know, you can be faithful and come to church, but you can really miss the big picture of what God wants to do in your life. You see, there's two ways that we can remember God's works. One is that read, meditate, and be amazed at God's word. You know, this week was super encouraging, coming off the week of the bump, to dive into the Word. And what was encouraging was there was a quiet time that I had early that really, it carried me through the week. And I started reading in Matthew chapter 1, and then I read into Matthew chapter 2, and I had read that chapter dozens of times, been a Christian for a while, but it hit me in a way that it never hit me before. But I was reading and I was meditating, and you read Matthew chapter 1, let me just be honest, it can be very easy to skip over. Because it's just names. It's just names of people. It's 14 generations times 3. And so you would think, oh, there's really nothing in there that I could get out of it for my own faith. But as I was reading and as I was praying, what really hit me that was inspiring was, my goodness, for 42 years or 42 generations, it was always in the plan of God to work through people. And what you see in there is some of those people in there didn't have it all perfect. But yet it was still God's plan to work through people, generation after generation, till the time of the coming of Jesus. I could have stopped right there, but I kept reading. And then I go over to chapter 2, and really, funny, when you talk about the birth of Christ, I mean, you can watch TV Christmas time, and it's presented the manger, the baby, the star, and all of that. But the Bible is so much more awesome in terms of the story. And so as I was reading chapter 2, it just hit me in a way I've never read it in 24 years as a Christian. You know, the whole story that when Jesus was born, it wasn't like in the most convenient circumstances because Herod was on the throne. And as Herod came forward, he pulled who? The wise men together and said, I want you to go search for this Jesus. And what I love is as the wise men, the Magi, went out, there was a star that was placed directly where Jesus was in Bethlehem over him. Following? But as the Magi went out, what the Bible says is literally the star went ahead of them. Like the star went. And I was reading that, I'm going to go, God is incredible. Like he can change the direction of the stars to communicate, this is my son Jesus, whom I love. Guys, you got to read and meditate and be amazed at God's word. Write these passages down. We don't have time to turn there, but Deuteronomy 7, chapter 7, verse 17. You may say to yourselves, these nations are stronger than we are. How can we drive them out? But do not be afraid of them. Remember well what the Lord your God did to Pharaoh and to all Egypt. 1 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 8. Give praise to the Lord, proclaim his name, make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him, sing praises to him, tell all his wonderful acts, glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. You know, Psalm chapter 22, verse 4. In you, our ancestors put their trust. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried out and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. You know, Psalm chapter 143, verse 5. I remember the days of long ago. I meditate on all your works and consider what your hands have done. Isaiah chapter 46, verse 9. Remember the former things, those of long ago. I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like him. Matthew chapter 16, verse 9. Lastly, do you still not understand? Don't you remember the 5 loaves for the 5,000 and how many basketfuls you gathered? Or the 7 loaves for the 4,000 and how many basketfuls you gathered? You know, what did writers of these books go back to do to try to encourage people? He tried to get them to remember what God had already done. But we have to meditate on his word and his works. Are you with me? You know, secondly, what do we need to do to remember? We need to also see what God has done in Philadelphia recently. You know, we've been here now about a year and about 3 months. And I started thinking about what has God done in Philadelphia in that time. Now, some of you have the advantage to go, I can go back 20 years, 20 plus years. And you have that history to just inspire what God has done through the years, through good times and through difficult times. But as I reflect on my short year in 3 months, I go back and I remember when Ed Stout was baptized. And then all of a sudden, married after that. And I remember when they first announced Ed and Angie's engagement. I mean, in literally the roar because they were rejoicing of the works that God had done in their lives. I remember when we first got here seeing Jenny McClendon baptized into Christ. I remember seeing Caesar Williams, who's now in the North, baptized into Christ. I remember in the last year the great community service that this church is continually providing for the city of Philadelphia. I mean, Saturday Academy is world class. And just to let you know, it's strong back up again. I remember back in the early spring, Jam Quest having its inaugural season, and the teams putting that thing together and really just raising money to help the city of Philadelphia. I choose to forget that I didn't win that tournament. But the money that was raised did serve a great purpose, a greater purpose. You know, last year, I remember it was the year of weddings. I remember seeing the Samuelsons married in Christ and the Outer Ridges married in the Lord. I remember seeing Will Hawkins get married. I remember seeing Andy and Manny married in the Lord. And as the spirit of Hebrews, I don't have time to tell about all the weddings that took place. But those are some ones that I remember very clearly. I remember seeing Spencer Moore baptized into Christ. I remember seeing Reggie Franklin baptized into Christ. And there is so much more that's happened. But that's what I reflect on that inspires me on what God can do in the future. You know, as the scriptures are speaking to all of us, you know what my heart's desire this morning is? Those who I really want to hear this message, it's those of you that are in the audience and you're going, wow, God's going to do it for all of those people, but not me. That's who I really want to be inspired this morning. Because that's who God is. Yes, God is going to bless the church. And isn't it interesting how we have no problem with faith in terms of what God's going to do with the Philadelphia church. But when someone comes up to you and says, what's your faith of how God is going to use you? For some reason, that's a little more of a challenging question. Are you with me on that? But no, God wants to use all of us. He wants to take our doubts by these great works in the Old Testament, but also in the city of Philadelphia, and be inspired by what He wants to do with your life in the future. Guys, if we remember what God has done in the past, truly, we're more likely to have faith in what He's going to do in the future. You know what I sit and I dream about for this church in the future? That God will continue to shine light through the city of Philadelphia. You know, I've thought of this a lot more recently, just with the sense of faith and urgency and the excitement. Is I dream about the church being at 1,000 again now. You know, for what purpose? Because there's millions of people in the city of Philadelphia. And it can't all fall on Gerard Durham to accomplish the mission. We need more people to be strong in faith. We need more people to become Christians and get their relationship with God straight. Why? So that the city of Philadelphia can be one. You know what else I dream about? I dream about our children becoming faithful disciples of Christ. Guys, we have to pass this on. We have to invest in our kids. We have to invest in the children's ministry. You know, I really want to hold up Ken and Rosa Baskerville. You know, we connect from time to time, but without me, it's obvious that the heart that He has for our children's ministry and the work that it's like a full-time job. That's how He treats it. But yet, the level of investment that He has, like, we all need to invest in our children. Parents, don't lose hope. Don't lose hope for your kids. But just be faithful. Hard times and good times. And let's see God through. It takes a village to raise our kids, right? You see, when it came to helping His people, in conclusion, you know, God wants us to have confidence and trust in Him. But what it always came back to was remembering what God has done. figure out the formula for spirituality. But really when it comes back to church, it's remembering what God has done. It's remembering that He could change the wind, that He could move the stars. But even more importantly, this day and age, He moves through people. He performs miracles through our lives that He's already done. And He's not done yet. Let us leave today with just a deeper conviction that I believe in His great works. Amen. Amen. We're going to stand on our feet. Closing by the song. For our fellowship, 7:05. Don't you want to go?
Thank you.